precious name of Jesus. Amen. Let's give the Lord some praise. Hallelujah. Begin our worship experience by singing, Lord, I lift my spirit to your spirit. Has anyone come to lift their spirit today? Yes. To the spirit of the Lord.
Amen.
In holy sweet communion.
Yes.
I sense your holy presence. Do we sense his presence today? Praise the Lord. The Bible says that we are to enter into his gate of thanksgiving and into his courts of praise. Did you bring your praise with you today?
Yes.
Hallelujah. feed. Fish comes in really the reward of what they do. And I find it interesting that in the churches of the living God that we serve a God who is going to give us heaven. Hallelujah. He's going to give us eternal life. And we can somehow just kind of maybe, if we feel like it, give God some glory.
all. Clap your hands, everybody. Jesus is indeed the reason for the season. And we give the praise, honor, and glory this morning. If you're glad to be alive, glad that the Lord has kept you, I want you to open up your mouth and make a whole lot of noise in this place. I said, give him a hallelujah, a glory, a thank you, Jesus. A yes, Lord, give him a whole lot of noise. Raise your hands and give him praise, honor, and glory. Amen. Well, I'm back and I'm feeling 100%, and I thank God for the touch that he has given me. Amen. And I owe you a whole lot of messages, and I'm going to try to condense it into 45 minutes this morning. I am going to preach, and I thank God I was awakened, and I don't say this lightly, I believe a divine visitation from heaven to encourage me as I get ready to stand behind this pulpit. It's good to see all of you. If you're a first-time visitor here at Heritage, just slip up your hands. We're not here to embarrass you or put you on the spot, but just simply to acknowledge you. If you're a first-time visitor here this morning, let's see. Okay, all of you have been here before, and I thank God for all of you. I do recognize Elder Joel's grandson, and Elder, I know you're way down the front. Yeah, Lady Joel is surprised, but your grandson, and I believe his significant, that's his wife? All right, I don't want to just pair them if they're not paired yet. Amen. But let's give Elder Joel's grandson, amen, a wonderful hand. One of the things that encouraged me this morning was to be in the office and have the members saying they're feeling the love that is permeating in this ministry. And I want to thank God for the Secret Santa. I was watching CBS News and how Secret Santas are going out and just donating gifts and goodwill to others. And I want to thank the Secret Santa this morning. We have some vouchers from the marketplace. If you have had a birthday last week or this week, slip up your hands. Let me see. All right, anybody with a birthday this week, last week? Anybody with an anniversary? Amen, this week or last week? All right, okay. All right, fine. Well, Roma, come. Help me, First Lady, or Brother James. Amen. Roma, we love you in this church. Amen, we do. Amen. So go to the marketplace. Get yourself at least a ham or turkey or something, some stuffing. All right? Amen. Let's give Sister Wilma a wonderful hand. Amen. All right, I can't forget you, Sister Sherilyn Jones. You marge, you're a birthday girl. You got on your red. So come and give this to Brother Donald. Amen. Meet her halfway, Brother James. You're superintendent. Marge up that aisle. Get some practice for Wednesday. Amen. Bless you. All right. Sister Altima, you did. We had a concert here. And I want to celebrate Sister Altima Burgess. Amen. Come on, put your hands together. Amen. Sister Altima, so impressed my soul, you know, because I know sometimes when you're putting on church events, you need a president, a vice president, a secretary, a recording secretary, and members. But Sister Altima was all of that. She was the president, vice president, recording secretary, and a member of her own committee. And through her efforts, amen, through her efforts, the church was able to put $5,000 toward the mortgage. Amen. $5,000 toward the mortgage. And so, Sister Altima, I really, really, really thank you for what you've done. Amen. Amen. I really thank you for what you have done. All right. Okay, what's next? Let's pray for the police service. I still serve as the chaplain, and I was called, and you have my condolences. I've been serving as the police chaplain for some time, and sometimes really the Lord is speaking to the police service. If it's not January, December time, he has a way of just getting their attention. And so we want to pray especially. I see you coming down Sandy Beach, who's here and is a member of this ministry. And I thank God for you. All of the police officers, will you stand? Let's see you and recognize you. Sister Marlon Cam. Sister Marlon Cam. Sister Cinder, superintendent Howard, for the job that you continue to do. And I know sometimes you're placed in the middle of some hard decision making and you have to get out there and get right in the crowd and that sort of thing. And since I was a policeman and knowing you put your lives on the line for us in this community, we just want to say thank God for you. Everybody rise on your feet now. Amen. Jesus, 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 what a wonder you are. Jesus, 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 praise Him, what a wonder you are. Everybody say, Jesus, 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 yes, let's go. What a wonder, Sister Kay, it's good to have you.
Set the stage. Everybody say, Jesus, what a wonder. Point your hand and say, oh, Jesus, what a wonder you are. Oh, Jesus, what a wonder. Now I want all of us to clap your hands. Come on, do like this.
Everybody say, Jesus.
Just edify you and encourage you. I'm not here to bring out
about beat you and whip you and spank you, you know, because life is already doing that to you, so I don't need to do that. I just really need to love you. The Holy Spirit will convict you of your sin, amen, and he will put you on a street called straight. Verse 2 says this, just turn on my monitors a little bit, Jamal. The people that walked in darkness have seen a great light. They that dwell in the land of the shadow of death, upon them hath the light shine. Let's skip down to verse 5. I found this interesting and intriguing. Let's read it together now. For every
confusing and garments rolled in blood, but this shall be with burning and fuel of fire.
Now, I know you had your breakfast and your Cheerios and your cutfish. You're sounding a little bit weak. I want you to shout out that fifth verse of scripture again. Let's read it again.
For every man is the confusion of God, and garments rolled in blood, but this shall be with burning and fuel of fire.
Verse 6 says, and let's read it together at that same volume that you just read. Verse 5, it says, for
unto us a child is born, unto us a son is given, and the government shall be upon his shoulder, and his name shall be called Wonderful Counselor, the Mighty God, the Everlasting Father, the Prince of Peace.
Amen. Take your seats now. I want to, and Reverend Smith, I recognize you, Reverend Robin Smith. I thank God for you. You're a master teacher, and this church has been exposed over the last few weeks to just wonderful teaching at a seminary level, and I'm not intimidated by your giftings, and I thank God for you that I can call you friend. I want to speak now for a few moments. It's 12:15, and if you respond with a few hallelujahs, I'm going to try to pull the plug before 1 o'clock today. From the topic, Wonderful, Wonderful Jesus is to me. Look at your neighbor and say, neighbor,
neighbor,
wonderful,
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 Jesus is to me.
Jesus is to me.
Find your neighbor on the other side of you and just smile at them and say, neighbor,
neighbor,
wonderful,
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 Jesus is to me.
Amen.
Just bring me that tube of toothpaste. This is the Holy Spirit brought this to my attention. There are some of you that have been going through much, so much that you feel and look like this tube of toothpaste. And I'm come to help you out this morning. You really have no more joy. Your joy's been squeezed so much. You're praying. You really don't have no more peace, you know, you've just been squeezed. I want to talk to people this afternoon who have been squeezed. I'm not talking, you know, philosophically, but I'm talking from my own experience, you know. Sometimes serving God, and the more sincere you are at trying to serve God, the more sometimes it seems like you're in the enemy's hand and all you're just being is squeezed. But today we're going to say, despite being squeezed, the Lord is still wonderful. So my introduction now to you, my brothers and sisters, you permit me to say, humanly speaking, or from a human perspective, oftentimes it's really hard to say that God is wonderful, if you be honest, meaning that God is awesome, he's miraculous, he's prodigious, he's incredible. When, like David, we find ourselves crying out to him, and it seems like the Lord is cold-shouldering us, and he even won't pick up the phone. Have you ever been there? You know, now we've got caller ID. I tell you, I'm going to preach to you, so you've got to roll with me, fasten your seatbelts, and let's get ready to preach together. When it seems like, you know, those of us who have caller ID, I don't, you know, subscribe to it now that I'm a pastor and a bishop, because, you know, I'm not criticizing those that do. Anybody could be calling for me, and I have to treat each call with sincerity. But sometimes we screen our calls, And we look at certain numbers, and when we see certain numbers, we're like, I've just not got the time for this today, and so we just let the phone ring and go into voicemail. And sometimes when we're serving God and we're praying to Him, it's like, you know, He allows the prayer phone to ring. I need a real church this afternoon for these 30 minutes. And instead of answering us, He lets the phone go to voicemail. And the question is, what do we do when we're ringing heaven and heaven won't respond? Daniel was there, and he said, you know, 21 days, nearly a month, I prayed to God. I picked up my phone because they tell me, Bob, that man ought always to pray and not to faint. And he said, come before Him and make your requests be made known. And so Daniel picked up the telephone, mother, and called on to God, but a principality got in the way. Find myself that now we're not wrestling against flesh and blood, and you got to know how to fight here on earth, because those demons will jump on people. It's not really people, it's the demons that we're fighting, and they'll start squeezing you, because demons have a way of whispering in the ears of people. And because you don't see the actual spirit in body form, you think it's Duncan, and you think it's Trot, and you think it's Harry and Susie. But it's a spirit, and we come this afternoon to take authority over every spirit. There are some jealous demons that are out there that when you start progressing in your life, they will start whispering to your friends. And if you don't believe me, ask Joseph. They started whispering to his brothers and say, it looks like you're trying to. He was like Martha Luther King, First Lady, and said, I got a dream. And that's why you gotta be careful sometimes who you talk to, because your best friend could be potentially your worst enemy. I wish I could get an amen right through there. Anyway, Daniel prayed, James, and you gotta keep on praying. I want you to nudge somebody for the first time and tell them, keep on praying, 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 keep on praying. The song says, prayer bells of heaven, oh how sweetly they ring, bearing a message unto Jesus your King. When you were burdened down with trouble and care, ring on and on. Everybody say, keep on ringing, and God will answer your prayer. He rang, and God noticed the principality that was stationed over him to block his blessing. And the Lord said, you know what, it's time to fight this. And I'm telling you, some of you, it's like being in the gym pushing weights, and the more resistance you get from the weights, the stronger your muscles are gonna be. I come to tell somebody, stay in God's gym. Some of you are carrying a whole lot of weight, you're shouldering, but the thing about it, if you couldn't handle it, God wouldn't put it on you. Look at your neighbor and say, you can handle it, you can handle it, you can handle it. Let me show you something, how bad you are. And the text says, for unto us a child is born. And I'm going to put a quarter in the meter and come right back to Daniel. For unto us a child is born. And I had to look at how all of us come into the world. You don't know you're a winner. You don't know how fast you are. And when your dad interacted with your mother in a sexual rendezvous, they tell me over 100 million sperm are released from the father, and it has to swim up the fallopian tube of the mother. It has to swim against resistance. So you come into this world not swimming with the current. You have to swim. Everybody that's been born, you didn't get here, although what mama did and daddy did was lovely, but you have to swim against the tide, and you have to compete to fertilize the egg. I want to look at somebody today and tell you, you're looking at a winner. You're not looking at a loser. You're not looking at a defeated foe.
Yeah!
your trunks and your swim gear, but the Holy Ghost told me to tell about 10 of you, pull out your trunks, pull out your beach wear in the spirit, and start swimming. Swim till you get to the other side. Acts chapter 27 reminds us, James, that those who could swim started swimming first to get to the other side. Now somebody needs to tell the devil, I'm going to swim. It's about how many days left to 2016, and I'm going to make it to the other side because I intend to swim. I want every swimmer to open your mouth and make some noise in this place. And I'm glad two of my counsels behind me. Let me preach to you guys, and you be Paul and Silas. So here was Daniel, I'm telling you, the principality of Persia, I believe, stationed itself in midair and said, you're not getting the package. I came home Friday, and I saw FedEx parked in my yard, and I knew it was only my son, because he's such a football fanatic that if he's not ordering a new football and football boots with socks, every season he gets a new pair of football boots to play for Dandytown. And I watched the FedEx guy come in the yard and block the yard. And what the enemy is trying to do is ensure that you don't get the blessing. I was at Orange yesterday, and a young lady, see, the enemy can so squeeze you. I'm not going to be much longer. The enemy can so squeeze you, Bob. Squeeze you, till he'll get in your brain and say, serving God is not worth it. How can you be serving God and sick? How can you be serving God and you're not married? How can you be serving God and you're lonely? And she whispered over to my wife, I'm just about had enough of this church thing. And I said to my wife, that's exactly what the devil wants. And you gotta understand, that's why I need a good church. Sunday morning, I'm not coming for no gossip. Sunday morning, I'm not coming for no drama.
Isaiah got a prophecy.
Yeah, yeah.
Yes.
And he looked into 2016.
Yes.
I tell you, prophecy is interesting. 2002, I got a prophecy right here in this church. And God said I was going to be the administrative bishop.
Yes.
And the church went real quiet. Because how could it be? And prophecy wasn't popular in New Testament in that time. But God had to give me a prophecy to keep me straight, lest I go off the crooked path and abort the destiny. He used Bishop Cox to say, in 2008, you're going to have to go through 6 years of hell. But when it's over, you'll be standing leading the church.
Okay, look at your neighbor and tell your neighbor, hang in there. Because if God said it, it's going to come to pass. No, 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 wrong, 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 wrong. Look at somebody hold their hand. I'm putting championship status on us and tell them, hang in there. Because if God said it, it's going to come to pass. And I need 100 people to give God an ovation of praise. Say it! And so I'm still on Daniel, first lady. He says to him that I'm going to have to send down stronger troops. Now I know, James, and it was hard. Many didn't like what the police did. But sometimes, you know, in the kingdom of God now, the troops have to come in. I'm not criticizing at all the police force. Because see, I'm a leader. And I understand when you have to make decisions, you become unpopular. Sometimes when you have to keep your mouth closed and don't give the rationale behind the decision, people look at you and think you're crazy, but they don't have all the pieces like you have. And it don't make no sense trying to explain it to them because they're not going to understand it anyway. But see, I'm halfway through this message, Reverend Santucci, and let me preach to you to tell your backup is on the way. I want you to point to your neighbor and tell them backup is on the way. Yes, yes, yes. You've been dealing with it. And see, the Lord said, Dr. Main, to tell now the people today, have that but if not faith. But if not. Because see now, we're so conditioned and it's not to our advantage as Christians to just expect everything, you know. What you're talking about? We have microwave now, so mothers don't have to cook. Put the meat out and let it thaw out and season it and put it in the fridge. And what you're going to cook on Tuesday, put it out on Monday. You just microwave it. And we go to McDonald's and we say, I'm like, give me a number 3. And if it doesn't come in 2 minutes, we complain to the manager. But in God's kingdom, he'll make you wait.
Big stick.
hear the Holy Ghost saying the troops are organizing for the church and we're getting ready for Kaduk. Look at your neighbor and say it's time for some Kaduk. And what the police does, you know, all they do is have their shield and the stick and they march in unison.
All right.
That's why the devil hates unity in the church. The devil hates unity. That's why we have to endeavor. Come, First Lady, give me a bag. I feel like preaching and help some of us out and get to this text and you get your ham and turkey. The book says, endeavoring to keep the unity. So I got to come back to Kaduk, so give me Kaduk, hold Kaduk right there. So in a church, Sister Holden, unity just doesn't automatically come. In a church like a marriage, you got to work on the unity. Because the devil comes to steal the unity out of the church. And some of you don't understand when you start talking as it were ray-ray, it's the devil coming to steal the unity out of the church. And you got to be able to say, Satan, the blood of Jesus is against you. The unity of heritage is more important than the trash man talking. I feel like preaching this morning.
Hallelujah.
And so now I become the thief. My wife's got her bag. No doubt her credit card is in it. No doubt her checkbook is in it. No doubt her makeup is in it. It's mama's bag in the same wrong bag. Now this is what the devil does in churches, and we play right into the devil's game. We're trying to hold the unity in the church. I'm finding out because you know what the heaven has shown me, the challenge that's going on in this church. Heaven is showing me the challenge that's going on in this church. What makes a Pentecostal church different is that the Holy Ghost is the secret servant in the church.
Careful, James, because see how you come in, good intentions like a superintendent. If you get in the wrong crowd and among religious folk, they'll contaminate you. Because I was on the police force, and I know they have a word called, compound word called backstabbing. And for a promotion, Bob, man want to be a sergeant, and what they'll do, resort to backstabbing. Come here, Latif, let me preach. I feel I need to preach this morning. I need to preach to this church. And so you look promising. You look, you could be a future pastor, future bishop. I've had 8 good years and I'm running for 12, and if the Lord wants to give me more, he'll give me more. I have to do no politicking to stay in the post. Yeah, so I feel that if you keep on coming up every Sunday morning dressed in a fat tie, your hair all curled and I ain't got no hair no more. Because how could Herod be intimidated by a baby?
Church every Sunday, but don't have a relationship with God. I'm going to tell you as a pastor, how do you know? Because it shows up in the way they behave. I'm preaching now. I've been preaching since I was 16 years old. I preached my little first, back then in church, you would get subtopics and sermonettes. So 16 years old, I started preaching. And I'm 53 years old now, so you make the calculation. Some people can preach, but their behavior is awful. Behavior is terrible. The behavior is disgusting. And if you're not careful when you go on the job, people see their behavior. And saying, they were in church Sunday morning, but look at them on Monday. No behavior. And I'm saying, because we're human, sometimes even I as a pastor can miss it. But if I'm determined to be an authentic Christian, what I'll do is say, you know what, James? The way I talked to you the other day wasn't right, man. I'm sorry, forgive me. Because, you know, I had a little stress on me, and so I wasn't at par where I should be. That's a sign of a good Christian. But you don't continue on in the folly and say, hallelujah, I'm saved. Hallelujah. Hallelujah, I'm living to glory. And so now this is what they were doing. Church folk were exploiting people. That's why he had to look through the camera and saying, somebody wonderful is coming. How were they exploiting people, First Lady? People that were on the top of the game. And poor people who had their mortgages. They would pull their mortgages and get their house and watch the poor suffer while they get rich. God raised up Isaiah. He cleared his throat and he said, whoa. Don't let, you know, in this time, First Lady, when you get dressed up, I may say, whoa, and that means you look fine. But now when God pronounces a woe on you, that means it's judgment. Sometimes we're having church, you know, I'm going to help you because I try to be politically correct when I stand behind the pulpit. You know, if a church is not moving right, because like the Tower of Babel, it can be organized and structured, and I'm not got anything against that. But when they were building the Tower of Babel, God says, I got to bring my wrecking crane in and level it down. Now, heritage, let it not be said again that God had to bring his wrecking crane in the church and level it so it can start again. He will pronounce a woe on anything that doesn't bring his name honor and glory. I know you're not going to like me, and I know you're not going to say amen, but I know I'm saying the truth as a man of God. They would get up in the morning and start drinking alcohol from the time they got up in the morning until they went down to sleep at night. And Isaiah said, because of that behavior, I'm pronouncing a woe. They would get up and pray. That's why when people get blessed,
sometimes wisdom tells me, keep your mouth closed.
Right. Keep your mouth closed. Because sometimes the truth is too strong for people. But it's the truth that's going to set us free. Yeah, people got up in pride. And God pronounced the woe. He said, you know what? Besides all that, the Assyrians are going to come in. Yeah. And the Assyrians, sometimes we hear confusing noise. I got up, I believe, Monday, and I was preparing for this sermon. And I put on my winter flip-flops in the house. And you want to see me like Michael Jackson, just sliding down my hallway. My wife was still sleeping and she said, pick those feet up. Sometimes The enemy, you can hear the enemy. I want to talk to people in my last 5 minutes because my 30 minutes is up. Sometimes I wonder how we allow the devil to just walk right in the church and nobody can hear. How you let the devil walk right in the marriage and you don't hear him? How you let the devil walk right in the parkway? How Bermuda? How we let the devil? Help me, Lord. Because, man, we were embracing, getting ready to embrace same-sex marriage, and I'm done. The devil said, you're to warn the government leader that something is afoot with your leadership. And he told me over the summertime to call him and warn him. And then in December, all hell is breaking loose in Parliament. But see, we thought it was a joke if we just sanctioned same-sex marriage, just entertain sin. Let sin come in the island. It's not going to be no ramifications, but sin is a reproach to every creature. And so Isaiah, I'm done. He said, I'm sending somebody who is going to be wonderful. I'm sending somebody, James, they tell me, and I'm done. It's $50 to $240 for one counseling session. One counseling session. If I come to you for counseling, it's $50 to $240. Yes. But when we pray to God, and we whisper a prayer in the morning, and the thing about him being our counselor, you may be a good marriage and family counselor, but then I need counseling for my children, so yes. I can't deal with you, so I gotta find another counselor. So that's $240 plus $240. All right, $480. And then, Jeffrey, I need counseling now for my finances. It looks like you want your bank book nice. And so that's, and you're saying, of course. So that's another $240. And that's $720. And then I need counseling for my weight. I wasn't finished. I was talking to somebody. Are you still with me? I'm finished now. And the person said, I had to go for counseling because I had to find out why I had an emotional attachment with food. So that's another $240. And then if you're not careful, what you should be given in tithe, you're giving it to a counselor. Yes. But if you give your tithes, the Lord will counsel you. Yes. Said, for unto us a child is born, unto us a son is given. The government shall be on his shoulder, and his name shall be called Wonderful Counselor. I like this. Next week, I'm determined to do it as I close. I'm going to get Huntley to cook a nice turkey, and I'm going to get Huntley to cook a nice ham, and I'm going to go to supermarket because I like their pie and get a nice pie and get some macaroni and cheese. And whoever wants to join me and my family in the hall, if the Lord wakes me up and gives me food to eat, joy to the world. The Lord is come. Will you clap your hands now? Let heaven and nature sing. Let heaven and nature sing. Let heaven and nature sing. Stand on your feet now, Zion. Joy to the world. The Lord. Thank you. nations. Just go like this with me, just go like this. Some of you, your enemies are scratching their head, wondering why you're still successful. But it's because God is wonderful. Some of you are even scratching your head and saying, how am I making it? But because God is wonderful. And we praise him this afternoon, and we glorify him. Will you lift your hands toward God? And even in the balcony, those of you who can stand, I want you to stand now in these closing moments of this service. One more time, we say joy to the world.
Joy.
You're more sick than you think you are.
You've been shouldering this responsibility of this church, and you're sicker than what you think you are. Squeeze. Waking up and my leg is hurting. I'm waking up and I'm sitting on both sides of my bed and my feet are dangling. I'm rubbing myself and my back is hurting me. But I'm here this morning. Everybody who feels. That's why I got up this morning to preach to those who feel like I can't think no more. Yeah, life is squeezing me. If you're not saved, if you're not saved, I want you to respect this moment now. I need my ministers to come and start moving. Get the oil. I need my ministers. I want my mother's intuition. My mom is going to lay her hands on you. My mom's going to lay her hands on you. Ministers to begin to move through this crowd. Get the oil. Hanamosha. Hekesha Namorosi. Yakobosha. Come here, Brother Joe. Come here. Come right through this line. You want to see your grandmother this morning? Come here, come here, come here. Don't be shy. Come here. Come here. Come here. Come here. This is serious to me now. This is serious. You know how long your papa preached? You know who's my confidant in New Testament Church of God? It's your godfather, it's your grandfather. He's the man that talks to me so I can talk to you. Brother Joe, give me a high five. It's working the vineyard for you to do. It's working. In the vineyard for you to do. It's work in the vineyard for you to do. It's work in the vineyard for you to do. Hallelujah. 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 Elder, I want you to hold your grandson's hand. Because God's been good to you and you know it. God has been good to you and you know it. Brother Warner, you're coming for prayer, but I want you to make a force. Four. God, we thank you. We thank you for husband, and we thank you for wife. We thank you for grandpa. We thank you for grandma. We thank you for being today. God, we all feel like life is squeezing us. We're crying out to you. Here is the seed of a righteous man. Your word says, I was young and now I'm old, but I never seen the righteous forsaken, nor his seed go begging prayer. Meet the need today. Honor their prayers, honor their faith. Bless the Joe family. I pray conviction over his spirit. I pray that it will help him to see the good things of the Lord. Bless Brother Warner. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Hug your grandfather. This is a righteous man. This is a great man. Hug grandma. She's a precious lady. Come. 1950, when James called me, Superintendent Howard, to say, "Pastor, we lost a police sergeant." I said, "What is life? People making a fuss about Christmas. Here's somebody gone. A week from Christmas, we'll never live to see it. What am I worrying about, stressing over? My life is in God's hands. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. You don't have to worry. I'm going to receive the tithes and offering. And don't you be afraid. I want everybody who can get $25 and consecrate it to the Lord. Joy comes in the morning. Remember, pain don't last always. There's a friend in Jesus. And if your heart is aching, just lift your hands and say, I know that I can make it. I know that I can stand." If you got $25 and I want us to leave together,
on this sermon.
shelter and strength. Thank you, Elder. Bless you, Father. I want everybody to wave your hand, do a Holy Ghost.
Shake their hand.
no Sunday school for the adult Bible class. There will be no Sunday school for the adult Bible class. But children, come at 10 o'clock and get your final rehearsal. Invite somebody at 11 o'clock. I want to see some of you at Miracle Temple tonight. It's going to be our thank you tour. Bless you. Bless you.